Stand, please. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us here tonight as we gather in your name. We thank you for the gift of life, the gift of faith, and especially the gift of our friends. We thank you also for bringing us here safely, Miranda Devine, and all those who have travelled to be here. Our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, teach us to follow in your ways and give ourselves to you every day. Especially as we discuss the human virtues, may we be renewed and strengthened in our own Christian vocation and discover how to live more faithfully and joyfully so that our whole life may become more profoundly human. Holy Spirit, we ask you to open our minds and hearts tonight to your guidance and instruction. Send us from this place with your gifts. Make us holy and unite ourselves close to you in prayer so that we can become saints now. We ask this through the intercession of our Blessed Mother. Hail Mary. Blessed Mother Teresa, St. Gregory the Great, and St. Mary the Cross, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. To our guest tonight, we are indeed honoured to have with us as our guest speaker for September, Miranda Devine, who is a well-known public figure and both a hugely busy journalist and a mother of two. Miranda is a leading columnist with the Daily Telegraph and the Herald Sun, where she writes a controversial and widely read opinion column twice a week, as well as an online blog, which generates just as much feedback. More often than not, Miranda is noted for her conservative stance on a range of social and political issues. And before working and living in Sydney, Miranda was born in New York and was a feature writer for the Boston Herald, and also had a stint on exchange in London. Miranda is also a member of the editorial advisory board of the Quadrant magazine and is regularly accused of voicing her conservative opinion. Yet she remains as one of the few left in the industry who hold fast to their values and integrity. Miranda is a highly sought-over guest speaker, and tonight she herself has requested to speak on the vanishing virtues. Ladies and gentlemen, let's make Miranda feel welcome.
Daunting. I've never spoken in a pub before, so I hope you all enjoy it and I don't take you away from your own chat. I thought I'd just start by telling you a story that I heard recently about two naughty little boys at kindergarten at a school called St. Philip Neri. The teachers had tried everything to make these two little boys behave. They had timeouts and notes home, detention, and nothing worked. Finally, the boys were sent to see the priest. And the first boy went in and sat in a chair across the desk from the priest. And the priest asked him, "Do you know where God is?" And the little boy just sat there. The priest stood up, stood over him and said, "Son, do you know where God is?" The little boy started to tremble, but he still said nothing. The priest leaned across the desk and again he asked, "Do you know where God is?" The little boy bolted out of the chair, ran past his friend in the waiting room and all the way home. He got into bed and he pulled the covers up over his head. His friend followed him home and asked, "What happened in there?" The boy replied, "God's gone missing and they think we did it." God goes missing a fair bit these days, and he's not often seen around a newsroom where I work either. I'm a columnist for the Daily and Sunday Telegraph, and my column is syndicated now across the country from Melbourne to Perth and sometimes places in between. So that means, although I haven't counted them individually, that I'm supposed to have about 4 million readers or more. Before I joined the Telegraph last year, I was at the Sydney Morning Herald for about 10 years, writing a column twice a week, but that was only for about 800,000 readers. And before that, I was back at the Telegraph, where I was a police reporter and assistant editor, and before that, as Jessica said, I worked in America at a newspaper called the Boston Herald. My job is to write about anything that might be of interest to readers, and to state an opinion about a topic, often a controversial topic, that raises people's passions. I have a conservative point of view, and sometimes people agree with me, and some don't, but the idea is to get people to think. And this sometimes makes people very cross with me. A radio station once staged a public debate titled, Should Miranda Devine Be Bowed and Gagged? I write about politics and social issues, about Julia Gillard and Tony Abbott and Greenies. I write about crime or life, Cadillac sports, carbon tax, the London riots, bushfires, teen binge drinking and the dangers of marijuana, cosmology, the new national syllabus curriculum, sex scandals in rugby league and MasterChef. I went to London earlier in the year to cover the royal wedding. I went to Bali to cover the drug trial of Chappelle Corby, and I was on the first Qantas plane into New York after the September 11 terrorist attacks. I've written about the big moral battles of our time, about abortion, euthanasia, cloning, embryonic stem cell research. I've written columns in war zones in Afghanistan and Iraq. I slept in one of Saddam Hussein's palaces in Baghdad. In Saddam's old office, I interviewed the brilliant US General David Petraeus. I've written columns about animal liberation activists who are trying to wreck our wool industry and stop us eating meats. They keep saying that we share 98% of our DNA with chimpanzees. They never mention that we also share half our DNA with bananas. So where is the liberation, banana liberation front, I ask. I write a lot about politics, and I hope this is not partisan, but simply factual, to say that the government's opinion poll ratings have declined drastically ever since Kevin Rudd was so brutally dispatched. There are a lot of reasons for this, but getting rid of a democratically elected Prime Minister in his first term is something that focus group research shows still rankles with the electorate. Mother Teresa could have replaced him, and even she would have been tainted by the manner in which she came to the job. Just recently, to mark the Prime Minister's first year in office, the ABC put together a word cloud of adjectives offered by its audience, in which the word traitor looms large. Fair or unfair, the manner in which she came to the job hobbled the Prime Minister from the start and continues to damage her. But any student of Shakespeare could have predicted this without knowing a thing about political parties, specific policies, or personalities. The public, it seems, often has a keener appreciation of right and wrong than do some of our politicians. It's not just in Australia. All around the West, the lament about the quality of the polity is the same, as people cry out for leadership of uncompromising integrity. But if politicians just followed the so-called cardinal virtues or stern virtues of prudence, temperance, justice, fortitude, and above all, humility, chances are they would not be in the pickles they find themselves in, and the national character would be elevated in response. As the last Pope's biographer, George Weigel, once said, democracies are not just machines that run by themselves. They need people with certain virtues and good habits to make them work. At a time when religion is on the nose and extremism is on the rise, that Christian heritage is under attack by a sort of postmodern moral relativism, by an anything goes radical tolerance, and what Pope Benedict calls aggressive secularism. This has eaten away at the moral foundations of our culture. It has weakened the churches and the will of good people to stand against the tide, because they begin to doubt themselves and what they know instinctively is wrong or right. And the little boy just sat there. The priest stood up, stood over him and said, Son, do you know where God is? The little boy started to tremble, but he still said nothing. The priest leaned across the desk and again he asked, Do you know where God is? The little boy bolted out of the chair, ran past his friend in the waiting room and all the way home. He got into bed and he pulled the covers up over his head. His friend followed him home and asked, What happened in there? The boy replied, God's gone missing and they think we did it. God goes missing a fair bit these days, and he's not often seen around a newsroom where I work either. I'm a columnist for the Daily and Sunday Telegraph. And my column is syndicated now across the country, from Melbourne to Perth and sometimes places in between. So that means, although I haven't counted them individually, that I'm supposed to have about 4 million readers or more. Before I joined The Telegraph last year, I was at the Sydney Morning Herald for about 10 years, writing a column twice a week, but that was only for about 800,000 readers. And before that, I was back at The Telegraph, where I was a police reporter and assistant editor, and before that, as Jessica said, I worked in America at a newspaper called The Boston Herald. My job is to write about anything that might be of interest to readers and to state an opinion about a topic, often a controversial topic that raises people's passions. I have a conservative point of view and sometimes people agree with me and some don't, but the idea is to get people to think. And this sometimes makes people very cross with me. A radio station once staged a public debate titled "Should Miranda Devine Be Bound and Gagged?" I write about politics and social issues, about Julia Gillard and Tony Abbott and Greenies. I write about crime or life, cattle exports, carbon tax, the London riots, bushfires, teen binge drinking and the dangers of marijuana, cosmology, the new national syllabus curriculum, sex scandals in rugby league and MasterChef. I went to London earlier in the year to cover the royal wedding. I went to Bali to cover the drug trial of Chappelle Corby. And I was on the first Qantas plane into New York after the September 11 terrorist attacks. I've written about the big moral battles of our time, about abortion, euthanasia, cloning, embryonic stem cell research. I've written columns in war zones in Afghanistan and Iraq. I slept in one of Saddam Hussein's palaces in Baghdad. In Saddam's old office, I interviewed the brilliant US General David Petraeus. I've written columns about animal liberation activists who are trying to wreck our wool industry and stop us eating meats, September 11 terrorist attacks. I've written about the big moral battles of our time, about abortion, euthanasia, cloning, embryonic stem cell research. I've written columns in war zones in Afghanistan and Iraq. I slept in one of Saddam Hussein's palaces in Baghdad. In Saddam's old office, I interviewed the brilliant US General David Petraeus. I've written columns about animal liberation activists who are trying to wreck our wool industry and stop us eating meats. They keep saying that we share 98% of our DNA with chimpanzees. They never mention that we also share half our DNA with bananas. So where is the banana liberation front, I ask. I write a lot about politics, and I hope this is not partisan, but simply factual, to say that the government's opinion poll ratings have declined drastically ever since Kevin Rudd was so brutally dispatched. There are a lot of reasons for this, but getting rid of a democratically elected Prime Minister in his first term is something that focus group research shows still rankles with the electorate. Mother Teresa could have replaced him, and even she would have been tainted by the manner in which she came to the job. Just recently, to mark the Prime Minister's first year in office, the ABC put together a word cloud of adjectives offered by its audience, in which the word traitor looms large. Fair or unfair, the manner in which she came to the job hobbled the Prime Minister from the start and continues to damage her. But any student of Shakespeare could have predicted this without knowing a thing about political parties, specific policies or personalities. The public, it seems, often has a keener appreciation of right and wrong than do some of our politicians. It's not just in Australia. All around the West, the lament about the quality of the polity is the same, as people cry out for leadership of uncompromising integrity. But if politicians just followed the so-called cardinal virtues or stern virtues of prudence, temperance, justice, fortitude, and above all, humility, chances are they would not be in the pickles they find themselves in, and the national character would be elevated in response. As the last Pope's biographer, George Weigel, once said, democracies are not just machines that run by themselves. They need people with certain virtues and good habits to make them work. At a time when religion is on the nose and extremism is on the rise, that Christian heritage is under attack by a sort of postmodern moral relativism, by an anything goes radical tolerance, and what Pope Benedict calls. Before I joined the Telegraph last year, I was at the Sydney Morning Herald for about 10 years, writing a column twice a week, but that was only for about 800,000 readers. And before that, I was back at the Telegraph, where I was a police reporter and assistant editor, and before that, as Jessica said, I worked in America at a newspaper called the Boston Herald. My job is to write about anything that might be of interest to readers and to state an opinion about a topic, often a controversial topic that raises people's passions. I have a conservative point of view, and sometimes people agree with me and some don't, but the idea is to get people to think. And this sometimes makes people very cross with me. A radio station once staged a public debate titled "Should Miranda Devine Be Bound and Gagged?" I write about politics and social issues, about Julia Gillard and Tony Abbott and Greenies. I write about crime or life, Cadillac sports, carbon tax, the London riots, bushfires, teen binge drinking and the dangers of marijuana, cosmology, the new national syllabus curriculum, sex scandals in rugby league and MasterChef. I went to London earlier in the year to cover the royal wedding. I went to Bali to cover the drug trial of Chappelle Corby. And I was on the first Qantas plane into New York after the September 11 terrorist attacks. I've written about the big moral battles of our time, about abortion, euthanasia, cloning, embryonic stem cell research. I've written columns in war zones in Afghanistan and Iraq. I slept in one of Saddam Hussein's palaces in Baghdad. In Saddam's old office, I interviewed the brilliant US General David Petraeus. I've written columns about animal liberation activists who are trying to wreck our wool industry and stop us eating meats. They keep saying that we share 98% of our DNA with chimpanzees. They never mention that we also share half our DNA with bananas. So where is the banana liberation front, I ask. I write a lot about politics, and I hope this is not partisan, but simply factual, to say that the government's opinion poll ratings have declined drastically ever since Kevin Rudd was so brutally dispatched. There are a lot of reasons for this, but getting rid of a democratically elected Prime Minister in his first term is something that focus group research shows still rankles with the electorate. Mother Teresa could have replaced him, and even she would have been tainted by the manner in which she came to the job. Just recently, to mark the Prime Minister's first year in office, the ABC put together a word cloud of adjectives offered by its audience, in which